Hey, Phil.
Hey, Nick.
How you doing?
Real good, thanks.
Cool. All right, everybody. Here's what we're going to do today. So Phil and I have known each other for a while, and we've done strategic workforce planning at Allianz. And so we're going to have a quick session going through some topics that we're going to just choose off the board, and we're going to make this kind of fun. So I'll introduce myself real quick. I'm Nick Garbis. I'm the VP of People Analytics Strategy at One Model, and I'm joined by my close friend,
Phil Mische. I am the head of the Digital Solutions Practice for Inspire 11. We are a management consulting firm that specializes in data analytics as well as digital solutions, and based out of Chicago, but also have an office in Minnesota.
Awesome. And we are here in downtown Minneapolis, and it's time to get started on this. So what we're going to do is, our format is, we're going to take turns choosing a topic off of the board, and then each of us is going to get 2 minutes timed to talk about it. If needed, we'll write something on the whiteboard. If not, we'll just go. So this is going to be about, like, our opinions, and I don't know if we're going to agree on everything.
Probably not.
Okay.
No,
so let's do it. So I'll give you the first choice then.
Okay.
So you go, and we'll get the timer started. So hit it.
All right. Let's talk about operationalize IT monitoring. You want to go with that one first?
Yeah, so operationalizing it, I'm thinking like that you need to be able to say how you're doing in a given year. So if your plan is to grow by 100 from, you know, you want to go from 50 to 150 developers, then you need to be able to see partway through the year how you're doing. So this is where I'm going to get my first try. If you want to go like this and partway through the year, you're over here, then you're short, and then you kind of think about, am I going to hit this goal or not? So as, you know, it's kind of an analytics element of this. You have to be able to predict if you're going to hit the number based on attrition, based on the number of postings you have, and which ones are going to close. That's going to give you critical information. So as an analytics person that's working with workforce planning, you want to be able to provide that early signal infrastructure. So that's super important stuff for me.
Yeah, on this topic for me, I think the biggest key to success is really making sure you have that program team on the ground, really driving momentum within the organization. Part of it is really developing that ongoing cadence of review, monitoring, and then adjustment. So I think a big success factor we've seen with organizations is having that program team that can hold the leaders accountable within the organization, that reviews the success, as Nick mentioned, of, are you really adhering to your plan? Are you starting to basically veer off of that? And if you do veer off of it, what is your course correction strategy going to be? How do you make sure that if you're behind plan or ahead of plan, that you can adjust that plan accordingly? Based on maybe some new strategic initiatives, maybe some new basically impacts to your industry and or sector. So it's really relevant to basically stay agile, nimble, and pivot as necessary.
Yeah, right. So if you're trying to grow and you're not growing fast enough, then you have an option to post more jobs, retain people, or work to shrink the time to fill. So if it's taking too time to fill, Phil.
Wow.
But anyway, yeah. But you can speed that up, and maybe you have to find out, we're not offering enough in the market. You know, we're not compensating people well. Hey, man, one down. I don't even think we need the timer. I'll put it there, but let's go. Oh, it's my choice.
Your choice.
Let's see. I want to talk about technology.
Technology. Oh, this is a good one.
Yeah. So, well, I chose, so you get to speak first.
Well, you know what? Since actually you are the technical person with supporting, you know, One Model and solutions that companies
right.
use, why don't you go ahead on this one?
Okay. So, my opinion on this is that, first, workforce planning is very process intensive. That said, if you don't have technology, if you don't have your data sorted out, you're going to be in a world of hurt. And we've been there. We've actually sent members of our team into some very painful places in the past because the technology we had just wasn't up to the task. And that would be like Excel models and
yes.
things like that. So we have a friend who's probably watching right now who's hopefully accepting our apologies. Thing is, you're going to need to have the data about your workforce. You're going to need to be able to organize it into talent segments. So all of your 17, you know, Java developer job types are going to need to be bundled into one thing called Java developer. That's a talent segment. And then you're going to need to be able to forecast that out. So in order to do that, you need your data. You need your data in a system. You need to be able to put that categorization onto that data. And then, you know, after you finish all your planning, this is where it kind of goes back to the operationalization. If you have that categorization done, when you have new people join those job types, you can actually measure your actual versus plan. If you don't have a system underneath that, so you, I think the foundational data has got to be, it's basically the same data that you would need for analytics. It's an integrated data set that allows you to look at your workforce through those lenses and see people's, you know, kind of coming and going, projecting out your job postings that are going to close by the end of the year, projecting out your future attrition, not just throwing a 5% rate on it, but actually a real, you know, a robust attrition model is going to vary across different roles. So there's a lot of the technology I think that's underneath this is going to be really similar across analytics and planning. And that's why one model is kind of in this space.
Right. And I'll probably look at this from a slightly different perspective, which is around skills assessment. So while there is a significant portion of workforce planning is around headcount and making sure you have the right number of resources in the right roles to really support that long-term strategy, there's also making sure that you have the right people with the right skills to support that strategy. So part of the process that Nick and I have worked on with other organizations is understanding what is that skill competency within the organization. So by role, do they have the right skill composition within that role, the right level of competency, and then really defining the future strategy and the future composition for some of those roles. And so it's important that whatever tools you use have that ability to do a skills assessment, which helps you as business leaders identify gaps within the skill within the workforce. And then another component of this that Nick and I had some angst about as we were trying to implement this solution was when you define these action plans, meaning the strategies to shore up recruiting and or upskilling or reskilling strategies, do you have a robust technology solution that allows you to easily track the progress that you're making with your workforce? Because once you identify all these different plans and strategies to shore up these gaps, it's as important, if not more important, to make sure that you're adhering to those plans. Kind of adjust, you know, going back to the graph that Nick had written up there, you'll have some plans put in place over a 3 to 5 year strategy, and making sure that you're adhering to those plans is really key to success for this part of the process.
Right, right. And those are the tracking of the actions themselves. Right. So the plans, you know, people committed to get something done by quarter or whatever. Right. You know, it's project management, but if you're doing this at scale, you want to know if you're actually moving the needle on those things that people are committed to. So I think that actually fits into sort of the technology piece as well. Wow, so here we are.
That's two.
You're up, my friend.
All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit. Actually, I'm going to pivot off of that and go right into skills granularity. So what is the level of skills granularity that we feel like you need when you're doing workforce planning? You want to go first?
You go first.
So skills granularity. So I think there's a couple of different ways you can attack this one. First of which is really to define, as you identify those talent segments within your organization, and you start to really understand what are those future capabilities that will be needed to drive those long-term strategic initiatives within the organization, you want to be able to drill down to the level of understanding as you look to define career paths within an organization or a specific role, or you're looking to really identify upskilling opportunities to really transition people into new roles that are needed within the organization as a result of the plan. Have you defined the right level of skills that allow you to build actionable items around? And so one example that Nick and I kind of worked through with one of the organizations we were supporting was, as we were looking to define those long-term global recruiting strategies or even upskilling strategies for the organization, we really needed to understand those 5 to 7 core digital competencies that were required for those roles. And so we worked with the leadership team to identify what were those skills needed and what was the level of competency. Not going so granular that it was down to a role level, but it was high enough that we could actually work with the talent development team to build robust reskilling strategies around.
Right. You know, I'm going to take a slightly different angle on this and agreeing with what you said is the level of detail that you need in a piece of modeling or forecasting or planning is only as good as how granular the actions you're going to take and what you can sustain. So we're going to use vaccination and inoculation as an example here. If we look at skills at the person level, and we're some people are totally obsessed about this, and that's why I'm addressing it, is if you go at the person level and say that what the what everyone's skill level needs to be on each thing, is that more actionable than just knowing where they're at a team level? So if you're talking about claims handlers, do I need to know that 10 people are very like this? Or do I need to know the claims handlers in this group of 10 have a deficiency in skill A, B, or C?
Right.
And my what I contend and why I bring up vaccination is, if we know that generally they are deficient in, let's say, agile project management, and they're going to need to know some of that. If they're deficient in that, we're going to give it to everybody, just like the vaccine for COVID. You give it to everybody, whether it's an exact match for their genetics or not. You inoculate across the board. Some people already knew it. Great, they're going to help the other people. So I think the level of granularity for skills, you know, you should look at the roles, and I would say this is skill A, B, and C, and this is, you know, role 1, 2, and 3. You should know what profiles you need. This one, this person needs to be high, and medium. This is low, medium, high, and low, medium, medium. You should know how proficient you're wanting them to be,
right,
for each one of these roles. And then it might be that this one and this one and this one are your priorities. Then you go get it. You know, if you know each person's skill right down to the person, you're not going to get too much more actual information, and you're going to spend a ton of time. So I just worry about people that go at this level of granularity, because I think that, and I say, hey, you haven't heard this before because this is new.
Okay.
Yeah. The Wright brothers didn't bring a lunchbox on a plane, right? They left it on the ground because you got to fly light when you're getting started.
Right.
So if you're going to get through your first year of strategic workforce planning, right, and you're doing stuff with skills, if you make it too heavy, you're going to crash.
Right. And I'm glad you brought that point up. Another thing, I think, just with regards to this entire process, is the first year when you're doing this type of work, it's really transformational. Most organizations have never been through this, and so it's a shock to the system. And so I think part of the approach that Nick and I would take with organizations was, it's okay to be a bit conservative. We would like you to be ambitious, but it's okay to be a bit conservative, because the more you do this, the more risk you will be going to take in the future, and the more, I would say, realistic you need to be and will be with regards to the changes that need to really transpire in the organization.
Yeah.
And I think that's, you know, there's nothing wrong with that first go around being a bit conservative. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I think that's right. Okay, my choice, I think.
Well, it is.
I'm going to go to change management, because it kind of ties in with some of what you were just saying. And let me hit this one first, because there's a story that I think we were using back in the day that I think is still very useful. And there's a couple variations on it, but let's use this. If you have your workforce, and every time someone leaves, that you backfill them with someone of the same capabilities, like you backfill like for like over and over and over, a year from now, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years from now, you're gonna have the same exact capabilities as today. So this is a story we would use with leaders, the sequence I would normally tell it is, take the workforce you have right now, fast forward the world 5 years and drop them down and tell me, is your business successful, yes or no? And to a person, they all say, we will fail if we have the same exact workforce. Right. Therefore, backfilling like for like along the way won't work. And that there is the job of strategic workforce planning, is to say, well, if that won't work, what is the workforce we need? Great, let's get started on defining it. Mm-hmm. So some of the change management, I think, starts at the beginning of getting the leaders on board with, why are we doing this? We're doing this because our workforce has to change, and it will change, but we should be engineering the change. We should be designing it and being deliberate about it and very intentional, and not just letting it kind of randomly evolve in nature. We need to make sure that we're shaping the workforce into what it's going to need to be to deliver the strategy. So that's kind of the beginning of where I started on change management piece.
Yeah, and I think another opportunity that I usually try to hone in on with leaders, especially with regards to attrition, is when you look 3 to 5 years out and the amount of attrition that will occur in a typical organization in the U.S., I'll leave Western European out of it because their attrition is extremely low in comparison. It provides a significant opportunity for leaders to reshape their organization, bring an entirely different complexity and really business model within the organization. And if done right, if people are very planful about the types of roles, the type of skills they want to bring into the organization, and then the strategies to actually implement those solutions, it really will allow a leader to really transform their organization in such a manner that they will not only meet their achieved targets or stated targets, they'll exceed them significantly. Another piece that Nick and I would often walk through with regards to change management is how you actually bring this topic forward within an organization. I think sometimes there's a certain misconception that strategic workforce planning is all about reduction in workforce, that you're basically going through a significant layoff process. And so sometimes Nick and I have used different terminology, different vernacular when we're actually bringing this into an organization, such as capability building or strategic capabilities within an organization. It's still the same process, but you're really reframing that for the organization, especially those organizations that have been through a significant reduction in workforce, because you want them to think about this as an opportunity to really enhance the workforce to allow them to really be successful in the future, that you're providing them the right set of skills to either redeploy within the organization or take on new opportunities within the organization.
Yeah, and also like you're creating a set of signals that are that the workforce needs to change in these ways and needs these new capabilities. You can take those signals and start pointing them toward the employees through messaging about specific trainings by saying the future of claims looks like this. And when the future of claims looks like that, these skills are more important and you can be part of this. So it allows, I think, the change management at the employee level allows you to start bringing them along. But you've got to concentrate the strategy into what are those capabilities that are needed in the future. So this is a really big piece of the puzzle. I'm not sure how much time we spent on it. I think we got it.
Yeah, we could probably keep okay. Looking at that one.
Yeah, I think you're up.
All right, maybe strategic versus operational. I always like that topic. That's a good one. All right, I'll go on this one. So strategic versus operational. I think you can look at this a few different ways. I always think of strategic as being that 3 to 5 year time horizon. You're really working with an organization to identify those long-term strategic initiatives that will really impact the organization. And then from that, you're really unpacking what is the impact on the workforce. You're working with those business leaders, identifying the drivers within the organization that are increasing efficiency, increasing revenue, potentially technology enhancements that are really increasing capacity for certain roles, which frees up more value-added activities. This strategic component is where when we start talking to organizations about what is the long-term play? What are you really looking to do with your workforce to help them to be successful in the future and really to really optimize your organization so you can be successful? And that could be, again, anywhere from revenue growth or operating efficiency. The operational piece, I tend to, Nick, maybe have a different perspective on this. I look at this as being a short-term play. This is what you do in the next 12 to 18 months to really help you start to transition your workforce to really meet some of those key objectives over the next, I would say, 6 to 12, 18 months tops. And that could be because you suddenly, maybe there's some regulatory environment change that suddenly you need to adapt to. It could be something that, COVID's a perfect example. Suddenly the entire workforce has changed because so much of us are now remote. What does that do to our overhead costs and the way that we actually staff our organizations in the near term and probably for the next year or so? So those are the differences when I think about this topic. Nick, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think people talk about strategic workforce planning and some people talk about operational workforce planning. I say the operational workforce planning kind of aligns with the budget period and is usually headcount oriented. Sometimes you can have something really strategic that is happening in the very short-term period, but it is about skills. It's about radically reshaping the workspaces and things like that. There's a couple things in play here. One is that the time horizons is one piece, and then also kind of the scale. And in operational, you're going to tend to be more on the headcount planning and aligned with budget. On the strategic, you're going to be stretching out beyond the budget period. Yeah. And I would say most importantly to me is that strategic workforce planning is about numbers and skills. So it's capacity and capabilities. If you're doing a long-term headcount plan that is a five-year thing, but it's just about the numbers, then I'd say that is a long-term operational plan. It might align with the strategy, but there's always a need for a capabilities or a skills component in the planning. If you're getting out to that distance, you're going to need to be thinking about skills.
Yep, absolutely.
So that's one of the things that I use as a distinction there. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
And we covered our five topics, didn't we?
We covered five topics. I think we did. So let's see. Let's see what's left here. Skills, great. Hey, we got that one. It was a duplicate. Deliverables, outcomes, value to the org, good enough. What do you do in year two? Process steps. So this is what we did cover. You already know that. So let's do this. We're gonna close it down for today. This was a lot of fun. We could probably do this for another 2 hours. But if you learned anything here, you like it, and you want us to hit any of these other topics or something else, I think we're going to post this somewhere where you can put comments.
Probably.
Yeah. So then put some comments in. Let us know if you want us to continue and hit any of these other topics. Happy to do so. Great to be with you, my friend.
Absolutely. Fantastic. Right. Good to see you.
Good to see you, too. Cheers. Bye, everybody.
See ya.
Cool. All right. All right. So...